Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to be talking more about the sociology of pure mathematics, and I want to contrast our general approach to science and the general approach to mathematics, in particular pure mathematics. So I think it's interesting to contrast these things and to recognize that they are essentially quite two different disciplines, even though they overlap significantly and there's a lot of interaction between them. The general orientation and indeed methodology of a scientist is fundamentally different from that of a mathematician. The history of the subjects are also quite different. And the way we think about the historical development of the subjects are very different. So to set the stage for what science is, here is a quote from the National Academy of Sciences and National Research Council, a document with a section called The Nature of Science, where they broadly outline what science is about. So this was published in 1984. So, in broadest terms, scientists seek a systematic organization of knowledge about the universe and its parts. This knowledge is based on explanatory principles whose verifiable consequences can be tested by independent observers. Science encompasses a large body of evidence collected by repeated observations and experiments. Although its goal is to approach true explanations as closely as possible, its investigators claim no final or permanent explanatory truths. Science changes. It evolves. Verifiable facts always take precedence. Scientists operate within a system designed for continuous testing, where corrections and new findings are announced in refereed scientific publications. The task of systematizing and extending the understanding of the universe is advanced by eliminating disproved ideas and by formulating new tests of others until one emerges as the most probable explanation for any given observed phenomena. This is called the scientific method. An idea that has not yet been sufficiently tested is called a hypothesis. Different hypotheses are sometimes advanced to explain the same factual evidence. Rigor in the testing of hypotheses is the heart of science. If no verifiable tests can be formulated, the idea is called an ad hoc hypothesis, one that is not fruitful. Such hypotheses fail to stimulate research and are unlikely to advance scientific knowledge. A fruitful hypothesis may develop into a theory after substantial observational or experimental support has accumulated. When a hypothesis has survived repeated opportunities for disproof and when competing hypotheses have been eliminated as a result of failure to produce the predicted consequences, that hypothesis may become the accepted theory explaining the original facts. Scientific theories are also predictive. They allow us to anticipate yet unknown phenomena and thus to focus research on more narrowly defined areas. If the results of testing agree with predictions from a theory, the theory is provisionally corroborated. If not, it is proved false and must be either abandoned or modified to account for the inconsistency. Scientific theories, therefore, are accepted only provisionally. It is always possible that a theory that has withstood previous testing may eventually be disproved. But as theories survive more tests, they are regarded with higher levels of confidence. In science, then, facts are determined by observation or measurement of natural or experimental phenomena. A hypothesis is a proposed explanation of those facts. A theory is a hypothesis that has gained wide acceptance because it has survived rigorous investigation of its predictions. And finally, science accommodates, indeed welcomes, new discoveries. Its theories change and its activities broaden as new facts come to light or new potentials are recognized. Examples of events changing scientific thought are legion. Truly scientific understanding cannot be attained or even pursued effectively when explanations not derived from or tested by the scientific method are accepted. Now, it would be nice to have a framework that's comparable to this about the nature of mathematics. And maybe there are such things. No doubt people have attempted such things. But I'm pretty confident that such a description is going to depart very, very clearly from this scientific one that we've just listened to. In mathematics, I would say broadly speaking, theories are not replaced. Okay, this idea that, you know, truth is provisional and that there's always, you know, a better theory potentially around the corner, that's not something that we generally acknowledge in mathematics. For us, mathematics is built up from previous theories, which are not changed or modified generally, okay, but simply added to, expanded. So there's this idea that it just keeps getting bigger, but the core or earlier results are still an important part of the whole story. So there's less of this idea that we have to revamp things, that we have to critically examine what's going on and maybe overcome it and look for something better, okay? No, rather what we usually want to do, the way it's usually thought of, is in terms of adding something to an existing theory. So this brings us to the large discrepancy between, you know, my understanding of mathematics, of pure mathematics, and the standard practitioner's point of view. So there's really serious divergences here. And one might ask, you know, how does one decide whether to, you know, listen to Norman, whether to take seriously what he's saying or to stick with the majority point of view, you know? So, of course, there's the sociological point of view that you just sort of look to see how many people are thinking this theory versus how many people are, you know, thinking this theory, and maybe the relative status or prestige of these various people. So that's very sociological. Science does not involve that kind of thing, okay, as I've just sort of laid out. That's not a criterion for establishing truth. The criterion is much more logical and much more closely related to the actual statements that are being put forward and the evidence for them. So, for example, I happen to believe that there are no infinite sets. In fact, that even the concept of an infinite set is not a concept that has any direct bearing on the true nature of mathematics. That's my belief. Most of my fellow mathematicians believe otherwise. They believe that there are infinite sets and that these infinite sets play integral, crucial roles in setting up mathematics. Okay, so how do we decide which of these positions is better? Well, that's an interesting dilemma, right? So aside from the sociological things, the scientist would probably say, well, let's look at the evidence, okay? A scientist probably looking at this would say, okay, one person is claiming there are these things called infinite sets. Another person claims that there aren't such things, in fact, that they don't even make sense. So a first thing to do would be to gather the evidence. Can we see some infinite sets? Can we observe some infinite sets? Now, your standard student is going to say, well, what about the natural numbers? We write a bracket, we write 1, 2, 3, and then 3 dots. Maybe we write a few more, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then 3 dots. And then close the bracket and say, look, there's an infinite set. But any careful scientist is going to look at this and say, I'm sorry, but that's not an infinite set. That's just 10 numbers followed by 3 dots. So then you could say, well, you could retreat from that position if you're a standard mathematician. Say, okay, we'll just let n be the set of all natural numbers. Okay, where is this set? It's a set, so show us the set. Well, we can't see the set. We can imagine it. We can imagine that independent of how far we've gone, we can always go further. Well, the scientist might say, well, that's a hypothesis that's making some statement about distances or events which are very far away from you. So your confidence about what you can do when you arrive at the edge of the universe or whatever is perhaps misplaced. Okay, you're not really in a position to say, you know, what happens when your numbers have already filled the entire universe and you're still claiming that you can add more to these numbers to get yet bigger ones. Okay, so I think it's fair to say that an honest jury of scientific sorts would probably argue in my favor, would probably come down on my side, that there is no empirical justification for the claim that there are infinite sets, indeed that the concept even makes sense. Is it possible to have a rational argument about that? You know, I'm willing to listen to different arguments. But just because someone can imagine something, you know, I can imagine, a land of leprechauns. I mean, maybe I can imagine another dimensional realm filled with demons and goblins. Yeah, so what? That's not the real world. Are we obligated to stick with the real world? Well, scientists would say, yes, of course. That's a silly question. So I'm interested in your points of view here. I think it's nice to have a discussion. I'm really interested in having this question out there a little bit more clearly. The distinction between the scientific process and the pure mathematician's idea of mathematics. And, where do these 20th century rather novel assumptions that have been baked in recently, how do they fit in to this story? Are they really justified? I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.